This is a bomber factory in Britain. The workers have arranged with their management and their joint production committee to build a bomber in the record time of 30 hours. And they asked us to make a film record of it. While some people cultivate victory gardens in their leisure hours, the people of this factory build bombers in their spare time. We went along with our cameras to try and keep pace with this record-breaking attempt. It was quite a job. So one Saturday morning, not so long ago, we had our cameras in position when the workers arrived at the factory. Everybody had the feeling, well, here we go. So we all took a deep breath and got set for 30 hours of non-stop real hard work. The clock strikes 9 and the record-breaking attempt begins. 2 sections of the fuselage are carried in. The dark girl with the riveter there is Eileen Daphne, who used to work in a rayon factory. One of her brothers was killed in a naval action a little while back. The fuselage parts are assembled in big frames they call jigs. These volunteer workers are giving the bonus they're earning today to the Red Cross Aid to Russia Fund. And they're out to break that 30-hour record they've set themselves. You can get some idea now of the size of the bomber. It's almost 65 feet long. Here is Evelyn Coates, an inspectress who used to work in a draper's shop. She told me at this point that she had found no faults at all. The workers were not only doing the job fast, but their work is perfect too. Across the factory and the wing assembly, there is more activity under the eagle eyes of the inspectors. Though you may not think they're working fast, the progress they are making speaks for itself. For it's only 10 o'clock, 1 hour from the starting time. Grace Wally and Hilda Dodd are doing a man's job of work, assembling the bomber's cabin heater. Back in the main assembly, the wooden floor is fitted to the fuselage. Notice how everything fits with precision. There's no bullying the parts together. One fits willingly with the other. The forward bulkhead frame goes in, and then the pilot's seat, control column, and the cockpit floor all in one unit. And how's the time going? Well, they've been working 1 hour and 17 minutes. Testing the flaps on the wings is Eva Williams, a nurse by profession, testing fractures in tubes instead of in bones. There's our chief cameraman, Chick Fowle, trying to keep up with the work. The short, dark girl assembling the ailerons is 23-year-old Evelyn Homewood, whose husband is in the Royal Air Force. She was one of the first 5 women to work in this plant. At 10:27, the foreman gives the word, and into the framework of the aircraft pile the electrical workers, armed with the tricks and the tools of their intricate trade. One of the company test pilots, Gerald Winnie, he was in the Royal Air Force in France before Dunkirk, stood beside me and said ruefully, "Like a lot of bloody ants. Hope they don't forget anything." But he had nothing to worry about. Construction went on, and the inspectors beamed with satisfaction. As you see, it seems to be a welter of wires, pipes, workers, shelves, fabric, and inspectors. But out of the clutter of confusion will emerge the completed fuselage. At 1:45 in the afternoon, the main fuselage is ready to come out of the jig. Let's flip over to the stitching and doping section. The 4 great sections which give the bomber its 80-foot wingspan are now being covered with fabric. Flashing fingers and winking needles. One wrong move, the needle would hit metal and the point would break. Agatha Hobson and the others who work here know where the stitches go. The fabric is bonded to the metal frame by about 8,000 tiny bolts, and stitches tidy up the edges. 8 stitches to the inch, and that's a whole lot of sewing you're looking at. Back at the fuselage out of the tail, Vera Butler and her sister Joan work together all the time. Vera was a lady's companion before she started building bombers 2 years ago. This is Phyllis Evans, who was in service as a maid before the war. She's one of them fitting the fabric covering over the framework. And here is the process of weatherproofing and strengthening the fabric. The grayish-white material changes to dull red as the dope goes on. 9 coats are applied, but it dries quickly and there's no holdup here. It's a habit in this factory to rather brazenly autograph one's work. So we know that Blondie has had something to do with this bomber. We haven't looked at the power units yet. A tiny brunette, Eva Powell, who runs a crane away up there under the roof girders, brings an engine the length of the shop and gently lowers it to what they call the power egg or nacelle. It looks like an egg at that. Norman Martin over there was once third officer on the pleasure liner Rawl Pindi before she was converted to a merchant cruiser. Norman has been working on this type of aero engine for quite a time and thinks it's the finest in the world. The girl with him is Ailsa Grindley, who would rather work on engines than in the confectionery store where she used to work in peacetime. The time has come to bring the component parts together. This means that the various departments are delivering their finished sections to the main assembly. And here they come. Now we'll see it take shape as a bomber. The fuselage is trundled down the factory at 6:15 in the evening, 9 hours and 15 minutes after the start. The cranes come lumbering overhead with the power eggs, which are gently and firmly lowered into place and connected up. Next, the tail surfaces. The elevators and tail fin, like a big black sky knife, are lowered and connected. Each part is installed by a swiftly moving expert team. This is the bomb beam, like a compact miniature bridge. Look at the speed with which they set the bulletproof petrol tanks into the main planes. When this is done, the overhead crane picks up the wings and sweeps them into position where skillful hands guide them into place. Now the bomber is complete with its 80-foot wingspan. It won't be long now before this bomber is loaded with an outward bound cargo for Germany at the rate they're going. The shift of workers changes. The night workers arrive along with the port air screw. At the same time, another crew is fitting the starboard propeller. And the time is only 23 minutes past 8 in the evening. The workers are beginning to make bets. For after all, there are still 17 hours and 20 minutes to go in that 30-hour mark they've set themselves. The rear turret arrives on a portable crane. Robert Davis skillfully guides it into place. He bruised his fingers nearly every day for a year, but now he handles the job as easily as he brushes his teeth. At 10:30 at night, the landing wheels are installed. Wheels 4.5 feet high that weigh 300 pounds. I don't know if you noticed her, but Ivy Bennett caught my eye. I noticed her because she was wearing a very sheer pink chiffon blouse. I remarked on it, but Ivy grinned and said she'd come away from a party in a hurry so that she could get on this night shift and help to make this record-breaking bomber. These are the inner petrol tanks. Amazing, isn't it, the way every inch of space is used. Before our unbelieving eyes, the bomber really looks like an aircraft. Ernest Tootle, who used to be a coach painter, applies the RAF rondel on the fuselage and wings. I don't know where he gets that steady hand at 3 a.m, for you'll notice that he does it freehand. Meanwhile, further inspections are taking place and checked off on the progress charts as each detail is okay. As the clock at the end of the assembly line points to 20 minutes past 3, a tractor tows the bomber to the running shed. This is a huge area at the end of the production line where final inspections and the first engine tests are made. There's a feeling of high expectancy in the air, for there in front of us is what we think is the fastest job of bomber construction in the world. Now, will it run? Like seagulls following a liner, the workers tag after it to continue their jobs. From Ivy Bennett in her chiffon blouse to George Williams, who is almost blind and who at his lonely little workbench hammers 42 gross of screws a day into long strips of wood, every one of these British men and women has given of his best. Then, at precisely 15 minutes past 6 on this Sunday morning, exactly 21 hours and 15 minutes from the start of construction, the bomber is a complete fighting unit and sees the light of the first dawn of its lifetime. This is a very special occasion, so like a gallery at a sporting event, the workers stand and watch. Then comes the big moment. The engineer climbs into the cabin, and the engines are started up for the first time. More inspectors swarm about the bomber, prying into every nook and cranny. We all know that time is racing, but still a generator and an air screw need some last-minute adjustments, and there's a final bit of stitching to do. This holds us up almost 2 hours. Finally, the engines, electrical equipment, airframe, everything has received its final test and okay, and the bomber is ready for the takeoff. It's full daylight and 10 minutes to 9 in the morning. 10 minutes short of an exact 24-hour day that the finished bomber is rolled out onto the tarmac adjoining the factory. The record is going to be really shattered and no mistake. Gerald Winnie, a really amazed man. He was planning to fly the bomber this afternoon, but so fast has this aircraft been completed that they got him out of bed to put the bomber through its paces. Record? Yes, they broke it, those workers. They said they'd build a bomber in their spare time in 30 hours. Its wheels lifted from the ground in exactly 24 hours and 48 minutes.